Thank you so much. It's so, so wonderful to be here and to see really good friends, and it's just fabulous. And thank you so much to Matt Wolka and Rick Botto and Christopher Burt for creating this, just this incredible, valuable space for music. So thank you. The concert is relatively short, about an hour of music, and then talking makes it a little longer, but no intermission, if that's okay. And we'll begin with Frangiz Ali-Zadeh. She's from Azerbaijan, and she evokes the stringed instrument, the tar, by laying glass bead necklaces on the strings.
Thank you.
Hannah Kendall is still in her 30s, but her music is being heard more and more, and the San Francisco Symphony has programmed one of her pieces for this October, which will be a US premiere, and the Berkeley Symphony commissioned a new work from her a few years ago. This piece is inspired by a 1763 poem by William Jones called Chiesa, and the first lines are, "Of armies on the checkered field arrayed, and guiltless war in pleasing form displayed, when two bold kings contend with vain alarms, in ivory this and that in ebon arms," ebon being ebony. The three movements depict the internal drama of a chess game, the strategy, and the impending knowledge of loss. I just want to read a little bit of what she says. The first movement is mind play, and it's a quote from Albert Einstein, "Chess holds its masters in its own bonds, shackling the mind and the brain so that the inner freedom of the very strongest must suffer." And it's all about, she says, it's all about the development of the pieces, gaining control of the center, and the conquest of space. These three conditions conjure vivid notions of battle and struggle. Mind play, which is the first movement, explores how the almost obsessive nature of this fight plays itself out within the players' minds. The second movement is middle game, which is, there's a quote from Marcel Duchamp. It says, middle game, she says, Hannah Kendall, middle game explores the flourishing visual transitions and potential patterns that occur as the chess pieces become dispersed about the board, seemingly scattered, and gradually deplete in numbers, standing as isolated figures. And then the coda, she says, it's difficult to define where a middle game ends and an end game begins. This movement acts as more of a continuation to middle game, as though the player who is going to lose sees that they have been defeated, accepts it, and lets the game play itself out.
Thank you.
Next, we have Italian composer Anna Bon. She wrote 6 keyboard sonatas. She was 19 years old at the time. And interestingly, her death date is often given as 1767, only 10 years after she wrote these sonatas. But that's actually the year she got married. and then she sort of vanishes from history. And she wrote all of the surviving, all of her surviving works she wrote before the age of 20. So here is a keyboard sonata from when she was 19 years old. The next composer is Agi Jambor. Best known as a pianist, her recordings are available, her Bach and Mozart recordings. She studied with Edwin Fischer and had a great career as a young woman, as a pianist. Then with increasing anti-Semitism and the Nazi takeover across Europe, she went into hiding with her husband. Her story is really harrowing. My friend Deborah has a book called Escaping Extermination that was edited by her grandniece, Frances Pinter. And that it's an incredible story about how she finally came to the United States and was active in fighting McCarthyism and the Vietnam War. So I came across this sonata and noticed that on the first page, I think I was looking at the Hildegard Publishing that publishes books, music by women. And on the first page, the sonata says, dedicated to, it's to the victims of Auschwitz, this sonata, but it says that Mademoiselle Jambor made a gift of the sonata to John DeMarteau, MD, who helped to bring this edition to fruition. And so I thought, who is John DeMarteau? Then I became obsessed with finding John DeMarteau, MD. And I looked him up, I Googled and, you know, called his office and left a message, and then I found he was associated with a record label, and I filled out a contact form, and I tried every possible way to contact him. No luck. And then I went on LinkedIn one day, which I always thought was completely, you know, why are we on LinkedIn? Except to make contact, you know, like accumulate contact. But so I found John DeMarteau and I wrote him a message and he wrote back. And so he lives in Washington, D.C. We got to work together by Zoom on this sonata, and he pointed out particular sections. There's this one, and I said, what is that? That's just like, what is that strange repeated octave? And he said it's that Agi Jambor, she had dementia by the time they met, and there was a lot. She sort of, her short-term memory wasn't very working well, but she said certain things in the sonata that she wrote in 1949. And so he said, that's the tanks rolling through Budapest and people are fleeing. And so there were certain parts in this sonata that are sort of descriptive of what she lived through. And I said, has anyone ever played it? And he said, she played it at the Phillips Collection in Washington, D.C. And she didn't say it was by her. She said it was by prisoner number, you know, 7356, as if it was tattooed on an arm, that it was written by somebody else. And it got reviewed in the Washington Post as a work by a prisoner of the concentration camps. So this is the piano sonata. I don't know if it's been heard since then at the Phillips Collection, but here it is. It's in three movements.
Thank you.
Well, it's going on a little longer than expected, but I hope you're okay for another. The next pieces are fairly short. Leokadiya Kashperova. This is another case where there's one person acting as an advocate for an otherwise nearly forgotten composer. So if you look her up on YouTube, it's Graham Griffiths who is talking about her and the value of her music. She was a brilliant pianist and was for a while Igor Stravinsky's piano teacher. And when she was 40, she impulsively married a Bolshevik revolutionary. I don't know how that even happens, but how you impulsively marry a Bolshevik revolutionary. He could predict the Russian Revolution and they escaped danger, but her music was never performed or heard again. These are a few pieces from a suite called In the Midst of Nature. The first is from Two Roses, and the second is The Murmuring of the Wheat.
Thank you.
Zenobia Powell Perry is a fascinating composer, and I'm so grateful to Ultras Concerts for finding videos of Perry talking about her work with composer Nathaniel Dett. That interview is online on the Ultras Concerts social media pages, and that interview was done by composer Jeannie Gale Poole, who publishes Perry's scores and has created a website with lots of information about her. I would encourage you to check it out. There are scores and biography, and just, it's great. And also I'm really grateful to the African American Composers Initiative based in Palo Alto. They produced an album of Zenobia Powell Perry's music with a terrific pianist, Jody Gandolfi and Ladoris Cordell. So this is one of her pieces called Rhapsody.
Thank you.
I'm going to end with two pieces from the color suite of Madeleine Dring. And she's a British composer who was also an actress and wrote for musical theater and the BBC. This was written in 1963. So two pieces, Blue Air and Brown Study. It's by Peggy Glanville Hicks. It's called Prelude for a Pensive Pupil. It's a good thing to say into a microphone, Prelude for a Pensive Pupil. Anyway, it's by Peggy Glanville Hicks. It's just 2 pages long.